I'm here to introduce the money manager this afternoon and to talk to you about what's happening at Trading Africa. We're talking about all things Africa, all things trading, how to access these markets. And this evening I've got with me David Wilcock. Thank you very much for joining me. He sits as the ACI's, which is the Financial Markets Chair for the Committee for Professionalism. He's going to talk us through the regulatory reforms that are being implemented in the markets, how that impacts the African exchange, how that impacts the African OTC markets, and obviously our investor forum in terms of how do you access Africa? How do you express your view? How do you do it in a way that is ethically sound and is also conducive to creating investment from foreigners abroad? So David, let's start and just let's have a look at your role at the Committee for Professionalism at ACI. Talk us through what's happening with this market reform and the biggest caveats that we're finding in the market currently.
Good evening, Bridget. So I chair the Committee for Professionalism, which is tasked with producing the ACI Model Code. The Model Code is effectively a code of conduct and best practices that is quite different from the other codes that we see around the world. So other codes tend to be written by regulators, by lawyers, and have a very, very specific language that they use. Whereas the Model Code is actually written by practitioners for practitioners, and we address the actual issues that people that are trying to get business done face on their dealing desks. It's also the only global code. So other codes are produced by regional people. So the NIPS code in the UK market is produced by the Bank of England and the FCA, but it concentrates very heavily on that market, whereas with the Model Code, we're completely global, and the practices that we've got in there, the recommendations we've got in there, are applicable around the globe.
So if we look at ACI as a Financial Markets Institute, one of the interesting things about it is it really is globally represented. So we've got 66 countries represented across all the regions across the globe. You've got, as you said, practitioners, and I think that that's really the key here. You've got people on the front end, people that are on the desks facing these scenarios every single day where they have to make stringent decisions that don't result in the institution being fined, especially now with the regulators heavily watching what's happening in the market and the perception of bad behavior. So if we look at these financial markets and specifically for investors that want to engage in markets across the globe, one of the key issues that has been addressed is honesty, transparency, and then obviously integrity. So speak to us about how the Model Code facilitates that and allays those fears in terms of people that understand and adhere to the Model Code, what that means for investors when you are dealing with somebody that has in fact adhered to those principles.
Yes, I mean, you know, I've spoken with asset managers who actually do insist with their banks that they disclose which code of conduct they use, and they particularly focus on the Model Code because it does address the issues that they are facing. So one of the key issues in the market is confidentiality. When is something confidential, when isn't? And obviously, given the market impact that some trades that go through the market can have, this confidentiality is key. However, the investment managers, they do want to know some market color. They want to know what's going on. And so there has to be found a balance between what can be disclosed and what cannot be disclosed. Generally speaking, from a viewpoint of the Model Code, we've tended to regard confidentiality as focusing on something that is really quite closely aligned to insider trading. So if you have information regarding one order from one participant and you begin to act in the market with the intention to make money, one, you're almost certainly going to be front running, you're going to be guilty of market manipulation, and equally, you're going to have a breach of confidentiality that means that in effect you're insider trading. And that insider trading is generally codified in the criminal law and has got very, very serious consequences behind it. However, when it comes to market color, market color has usually been expressed by banks being able to view what a multitude of people are looking to do in the market. So they've looked at their order books, they can see what flows are likely to occur, at roughly what levels they're likely to occur, and generally speaking, the sharing of that market color based on total aggregated information, which is not pertinent to one particular participant or one particular order, is generally okay. However, we've got the Fair and Effective Market Review taking place in the United Kingdom. It's a joint review between the Bank of England, Her Majesty's Treasury, and also the FCA, which is the UK regulator. And in that review, and they've got their documents up on the website, they've just had the replies to their consultation back, they have a box which actually lists where the grey areas are. And one of the key grey areas is regarding this market colour. Mm. Now, what's interesting is that, you know, people have spoken about it, etc., but quite a few buy-side clients of banks have actually contacted the regulator and saying, we now have a problem. We are being told by our banks that they can no longer service us with the type of information we need to make sensible investment decisions because of your regulations. Mm. And I think everyone's now very aware of that problem. We will be looking very closely at what happens post the Fair and Effective Market Review, because it appears that everyone around the globe is now looking at that one review before they make any moves. And we will dissect what they say, and we will try in the model code to come up with a much more robust real-life example of what you can and what you can't do.
So let's talk about the different types of participants in the market, because you've got the buy side, which is your investment managers, your private individuals, you have your asset managers, your hedge funds, etc. So these are people that are asking for prices from the market. And traditionally, your sell side were the banks or the brokers or people that provided pricing or were prepared to make a market. So historically, you had guys taking positions on the back of client flow, either to hedge themselves out or because they thought that it was a great trade, etc. So these types of mechanisms that are in place, does the model code look across the broad spectrum from the buy side to the sell side? So whether you're an investor looking to invest in the markets, do these rules apply to you as they do within the banking sector and within those price-making forums?
Yes, I mean, absolutely. So the model code is written, obviously, with a focus on over-the-counter wholesale markets. We write it with all participants in mind. Obviously, traditionally, it has been more heavily geared towards banks. And in fact, quite a few participants now in the market, both from the corporate and from the investment management sector, have said to us, actually, we like what is in the model code. Is it possible that perhaps we could produce one that's very specific to us? So we are actually looking at that. We're looking to produce one that will be applicable to asset managers. Now, asset managers are regulated entities, so we'll be looking at the regulations that actually affect them, tease out what's required, and actually put that into the code. For corporates, it's a different situation. Corporates, by and large, are not regulated, but they do have accounting standards. So we'll be looking at the IASB, mm-hmm. which is the international accounting body, and we'll be seeing what it says about what is appropriate hedging, et cetera, and we'll put that in. But when it comes to ethical behavior, it always takes two people to make a trade. And in that situation, it's very useful if both are coming from the same ethical standpoint, i.e. they both agree to one code. And you know, certainly on trading platforms, which in a way are very similar to the brokers of old, quite a few of them actually do use the model code and cite the model code in their terms and conditions, which go both to the liquidity provider and to the consumer of the price. So we are already seeing this proliferation of ethical behavior across the market, and it's something that we will do everything we can and invest in to actually facilitate further.
So it's quite interesting that you say that, because I think that one of the fears that we have currently is it's that unknown. You've got this barrage of information that's being thrown at you. You know that people are landing in prison. There's huge fines being issued. There's all these rules and regulations that are now on the table. There's the likes of the EMR. You've got the ECB. You've got the BOE. You've got Dodd-Frank in the US. You've got all of these various scenarios. If we want to trade with foreign counterparts, however, from an African perspective, we have to be part of that language that the market speaks and adhere to those regulations, or we won't see that type of transaction. So it feels to me as though the market's moved from one side of the pendulum where it was relatively unregulated or self-regulated to a completely opposite side of the pendulum that has swung to completely over-regulated, where people are too scared to step to the left or to the right for the misunderstanding or the assumption of the stringentness of the regulations. And the model code, with regards to the format of understanding the scenarios, talk us through how the model code puts you in scenarios and makes it really relevant in terms of day-to-day decisions that you're faced with that impact you, and how the code speaks to the behavior that is expected of you as you speak a common language across the market, whether you're talking to somebody in Denmark, in the UK, in China.
Okay, so I am firstly just coming onto the regulation side of things. I think you're right that for derivatives, regulation has been tightened up significantly, and I think there have been unintended consequences, and I think going forward we're going to have to amend certain parts, particularly of the Dodd-Frank Act, and also I think that when we come to the big European legislation, which is MiFID II, I think that they will have been able to take into account and seen what happened there and frame appropriate regulation. For the foreign exchange market, in particular, that will impact forwards, non-deliverable forwards, options. But for the spot foreign exchange market, we haven't seen too much regulation come in. So the spot foreign exchange market continues as a wholesale over-the-counter self-regulated market.
However, the thing is, though, that you do have individuals who are expected to behave in a certain manner. So the regulations, as much as they don't impact the actual product, impact the individual who is creating that market within that product, which almost every entity that we know trades in.
Absolutely. So the participants are regulated. But when it comes down to how you influence behavior, regulation isn't very good at ethical behavior. Ethical behavior starts with the individual, and you know, in any profession, you do see people arrive with criminal intent, they want to defraud, they want to cheat, etc.
But then you also have people that don't have that intention, Dave. So yep. It's not to say that everybody has that intention.
Correct.
But as you said, the word here is really around the intent of the individual.
Correct.
But then it's trying to understand whether your intent is in fact correct or incorrect.
Right, so I think that on that side, I mean, one thing that we're doing at ACI, the Financial Markets Association, is we're introducing a program of self-certification and education. So for quite some time now, we've offered an exam on the model code, which tests people's understanding of it. And we do also advise in the examination process that it isn't just understanding the written word, it's understanding the spirit behind it, and that you are going to approach it in a professional manner, and you're going to always be mindful of the code, both in your personal conduct and in your business life. The next stage on from that is that the education will be available online. It will be in the form of modules, and alongside it will be a scenario tool. So this will have scenarios which are drawn on everyday people's experiences in the markets, and we will look at the scenario where perhaps it is on one of those grey areas where it isn't exactly certain where the line is, and we will give advice on exactly where we see the line in terms of the model code and what we recommend is the correct behaviour. You then go through that, and which is, you know, a fairly common process, I think, in other professions, and at the end of it, we will have this self-certification where people are able to test themselves, test that they got it right, and their banks will then be given the access to that tool so that they can be certain that at least the individuals understand what the ethics of the market are and what standards are expected of them.
Well, thank you very much, Dave. I really do appreciate that. And I think that the exciting thing that we're talking about here is that it's about ethical principles. We assume that we have them, but are you really sure? And when you're dealing with your counterpart, whether you're on the buy side or the sell side, whether you want to invest or whether you're making a market, ensure that you are doing it within the correct paradigms that are expected of you from your behavior, not based on an assumption, but based on the real understanding of market participants, so that you don't get into trouble with the authorities. And also, when you're dealing with your counterpart, that you're sure that you're dealing with somebody that is honest, integrous, and has the right integrity behind them in terms of their incentive around the motive or what they're trying to achieve for you. So today's show is over, but I'd like to thank you once again for joining me, replacing Lindsay, and hopefully his home hasn't burnt down. And we'll join you next week. This is The Money Manager.